this morning. Won't you stand up with us and we'll jump into word.
You and nothing.
Come rest on us.
said you would. Your word is not in vain. Our hearts reaching heavenward. Breath outpouring, tear the fabric open. Come, Jesus, come.
Come on, if you need a refreshing from the Holy Spirit, come on, you just need to be refreshed. You need to be renewed. Come on, you just need some strength in this place. I feel the Spirit of the Lord so strongly here. And He's here to give you strength. He's here to give you hope, maybe restoration, maybe freedom, but He's here for you today. And I don't want to pass this opportunity without this moment without giving the opportunity to reach and to grab that strength. So if that's you, you just need strength. You need some renewing. Come on, I feel there's a renewing and there's a refreshing this morning. You don't have to walk around with old, stale faith, but God wants to give you a new and a fresh faith this morning. Come on, you just need a refreshing. Can you just lift your hands to heaven right now? Father, would you come today? God, would you come and refresh us? Holy Spirit, would you come and renew us? God, would you come and take away, God, the old and the stale, and would you give us a fresh faith, a new faith? God, a fresh desire. God, a fresh passion. God, not yesterday's, not last month's. God, not last year's, but God, a fresh passion. God, a fresh desire inside of us. God, for more of your Spirit, of more of your goodness. God, we're desperate and we're hungry for a fresh... Come on, is there anybody desperate and hungry for a fresh outpouring of the Spirit of God? Come on, is there anybody hungry and desperate that says, God, I need you to show up in my family. God, I need you to show up in my marriage. God, I need you to show up in my church. I need you to show up in my community because there's a fresh outpouring. But all you've got to do is to cry out to God and to cry out to heaven. Come on, is there anybody willing to stand in the gap? Is there anybody willing to say, God, I'll cry out? Is there anybody willing to say, God, I need more? God, we need refreshing. God, we need renewing. Father, right now, stir inside of us. Oh, Holy Spirit, come and stir inside of us. God, come on us with power and boldness and with strength. God, a refreshing and a renewing. God, that you would rain down your Spirit afresh and anew. God, that greater is in the latter than that which was in the former. God, we're desiring and we're desperate for more. God, we're not satisfied with just a touch, but God, we want all of you. Jesus, we want all of you. Jesus, we want all of you. Come on, just begin to ask Him. Begin to say, God, more. Come on, begin to declare that. God, more. Come on, begin to speak that out. Come on, church. God, more. God, more. God, more. Holy Spirit, more. Holy Spirit, more. Holy Spirit, more. Come on, Holy Spirit, more. Come on, right now, declare that. Holy Spirit, more. God, we want more. We want more. We want more. We want more. God, we want more. Oh, Holy Spirit, more of you and less of us. More of you and less of us right now. Right now. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. God, a refreshing and a renewing. God, a refreshing and a renewing. I feel the Lord saying that so many of us in this room, we've become satisfied. But God is saying, don't be satisfied with where you're at because there's more. Don't be satisfied with where you've been because He wants you to take you to somewhere new. Come on, do you get what I'm saying, church? That there's so much more that you haven't even seen it, that you can't even fathom where God wants to take you and what God wants you to do. But He's saying, you've got to be willing to reach out. So you can't just sit back and say, okay, God, I want more. No, you've got to step into it. Come on, if that's you and you just want more, can you just lift your hands? I want to pray for you. Father, right now, Lord, I pray that we would be a church, that we would be a body of believers, God, that would desire more of you. God, that we would not be satisfied with the things that you've done or the places that we've been or the miracles that we've seen. But Lord, I pray that we would have a hunger and a passion for more of you and more of your glory and more of your goodness. God, it's not about revival, but it's about you. God, it's not about us, but it's about the lost. So, Father, I pray right now, God, for more so that we could reach more people, for more, God, so that we could see more healing, so we can see more miracles, so that you can be glorified. Holy Spirit, I pray right now that you would sweep across this room, that every person here that says, I want more, God, give them more. That every person that says, God, I'm looking for what's next, God, show them what's next. For every person that says, God, how can you use me? God, show them right now how you can use them. For every person believing for their family, God, begin to speak to their family even now, that even they're not at church, but God, you're still speaking to them. God, for those that need a miracle in their body, God, that more, God, we pray for miracles and signs and wonders. God, let it start here. Let it start now. God, I pray for a refreshing and a new strength that some of us, we're weary and we're tired. But Father, I pray right now for a refreshing and a renewed strength in the name of Jesus. God, for more. I feel the Lord saying, get ready because he's taking you to new levels. I feel the Lord saying, get ready because he's taking you to new places. I feel him saying, come on, get ready because the rain, the clouds are gathering, and he's about to release the floodgates, and the rain is about to pour out, the rain from heaven. The rain of the Spirit of God is about to be released on your sons. I feel the Lord saying that on your sons and your daughters, that your children and your children's children, that the Spirit of God is going to be released on them. But in order to see that, God is saying that you have to step into that place of more. That you've got to step into that new place. Father, right now we declare that we want more. God, we're going to step into that new place. God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for what you're doing. God, we give you all the glory and all the praise, God. God, that when we come expecting you to speak, God, that you speak. When we come expecting you to show up, God, that you show up. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you would continue to move through the remainder of today. God, we love you. We thank you. We give you all the glory and all the honor. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Listen, before you're seated this morning, turn to somebody, greet somebody, welcome them, and welcome to Creola Assembly. How many of you were here this past Sunday for our Freedom Fest? Was anybody here? Yeah, you're supposed to make some noise. Come on, wasn't that an awesome night? It was so awesome. We had so many people come out that night. It was amazing. And we're just believing that that's going to catapult us and launch us into this school year and this new season of all that God's going to do. But we've got a great event coming up this week, actually starting on Friday night, that we would love for you guys to be a part of. We need your help. Pastor Ashley, tell them about our Family Fest.
So we're going to have Family Fest on Friday and Saturday night at 6:30 and then Sunday morning at 10 a.m. And we're going to have Pastors Andy and Scotty Miller. And they're going to come in and we're going to have a kids takeover, but we need everyone to be here because it's going to be so much fun. It's going to be something you want to bring your families to, your neighbors to, and we're just excited about it. There's going to be puppets. There's going to be inflatables. There's going to be hot candy and popcorn for pre-service. Our doors will open at 5:30 every night, and service will start at 6:30. And we need as many volunteers as possible that can help because it's a lot that we need to do. We're really excited about what God's going to do this weekend.
If you haven't signed up in the back, make sure you do that. And then also, we need everybody. We've got flyers there. If you could just grab a stack of flyers on your way out, take them and pass them out. And it's not called Kids Fest. It's called Family Fest, right? So we want you here. We want parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins. We want all of you here. It's going to be a great day. And we're believing, you know, our vision is to see souls saved, lives changed, and believers connected and empowered. We believe through this event, our lives are going to be changed, souls are going to be saved. And we believe this event is going to connect them to our church so that God can empower them to walk the life that he's called them to walk. Do you believe that?
That's right.
Amen. And then August is going to be a special month. It's going to be family month. We're going to be doing a series on family. It is going to be so amazing. Every Sunday we're going to have something special for families. It is going to be the best month ever. So you're going to make sure you're here every week in August for our family month. Also in August we'll have our youth back to school bash and our kids back to school bash as well. And then August 14th is Nights of Revival. We haven't done one through the summer, but we're bringing them back on August 14th. It's going to be a great night. It's just a night where we believe that God's still moving. Come on, do you believe that? That God still moves in churches. Come on, that Pentecost is still alive, that the Holy Spirit still empowers. And it's just a night where we come expecting and believing that God is going to show up and God is going to empower people. So make sure, mark your calendars. August 14th is a Sunday night. And, you know, I tell you, if you're a real Christian, you come on a Sunday night, right? So you got to be here or we're going to be questioning your Christianity. So make sure you're here August 14th. But those are some of the few things we have going on. But, you know, we want to pause right now and we want to honor everybody who gives, everybody who's given. You know, it's such a privilege to be your pastors and to serve you guys. But it's such an honor that you would give to the vision, give to the house of God. And God blesses that. You know, last week what we did, we had over 250 people on property. And we were able to do that because of your faithfulness and your giving. We're able to be the hands and feet of Christ because of your faithfulness and giving. And I want to encourage you, we are stewarding your finance as well. That when you give, we're not lining pockets, but we're lining the kingdom of heaven. Amen. That is our goal, that we want to see the kingdom of heaven full, right? We want to see hospitals empty. We want to see churches full, and we want to see heaven full. And we're able to do that through your giving. So I just want to say thank you so much for giving. There's multiple ways that you can give. You can give online on our church website, creolaag.org. Just hit the gift tab. You'll be prompted of how you can give there. Or you can text the number 84321. Just text the amount you would like to give. You can give that way. And then also, as always, you can give in person. We don't pass a plate because, listen, if you're our guest this morning, there is no there's no obligation for you to give. We just want you to come and to be our guest. But you can give at our drop boxes, at our exits. Come on, isn't it an opportunity? Isn't it a privilege that we get to give in the kingdom of God? Come on, I believe that when we get to heaven, that there's going to be people that are running up to us and saying, thank you so much for giving. Thank you so much for being faithful. Because you gave, I heard about Jesus. Because you gave, I was set free from addiction. Because you gave, and not just here, not just at Creola, but around the world, because we're a missions-giving church, that people around the world that look different, that speak different, they're going to come to us and tell of how we gave. They were able to hear about the good news of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Pastor Ashley, can you pray over all of our tithes and offerings that we'll be receiving this morning? Well, it's Flex week number 4. We've been looking at the life of Samson. Have you guys enjoyed this series? We're almost done, but man, God has just been doing amazing things. This is a story that I know, but I know every week when I open up and I begin to study, God just reveals and shows me new things. Isn't that awesome? When you read a story in the Word of God, you know it, but you read it and God begins to reveal things to you. It's so awesome, and the reason is because the Word of God is alive and it's living, that it's not dead, but it's alive and living. It's speaking to us today. You know, throughout this series, we've looked at the life of Samson, and we have seen some of his highest highs, and we've seen some of his lowest lows. We've seen some of his greatest victories and some of his greatest failures, right? We've seen him get married. We've seen him kill 1,000 people with the jawbone of a donkey. We've seen him alone, all alone in a cave. We have seen so many things. We looked at even his conception at birth, how he was marked at birth. And this week, we're kind of drawing to an end. We're heading towards the end of the life of Samson. You know, last week, we read how Samson defeated 1,000 of the Philistines with the jawbone of a donkey. Y'all remember that? We read that, and it says, for 20 years, Samson continued to judge. So throughout those 20 years, there's not a whole lot that we know of happened. There's only one other instance that we read about before we get to where we're at today, and that's where Samson goes, and he tears the pillars off and tears the gates off. But I want to read this morning, and I want to look in Judges chapter 16. If you're here, I want to look in Judges chapter 16. And so Samson, he's been judging Israel. He's been ruling over Israel, and he finds a woman, right? It's a common theme for Samson, right? If you read the story of Samson, it's a common theme. He is finding women, but it says he finds this woman. The Bible says that he finds her and he loves her, okay? He doesn't just look at her. He doesn't just lust after her, but the Bible says, I'm sure there's some of that, but it says that he loves her. And as he begins to fall in love with this woman, her name's Delilah. Anybody heard of Delilah? right? Anybody heard of Delilah? Oftentimes we hear that name and we're like, we think automatically think bad things, right? But I want to look this morning at the story of Samson and Delilah. If you're taking notes, I want you to write down, what is my Delilah? I want you to ask yourself that question. I want everybody, maybe if you can, to write that down, put it in your phone, whatever, because I think this is important. What is my Delilah? What is my Delilah? Because I believe by the end of this message, we're going to be able to look and we're going to say, this is my Delilah. This is my Delilah. Can we pray this morning before we get in the Word of God? Father, I thank you. I thank you for the opportunity to be able to preach, to be able to share your message. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would empty me of myself. God, fill me of your Spirit, God, so that your Word can go forth. God, we love you. We thank you in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. So Samson and Delilah are together. They're sleeping together. They're spending time together. It seems like, if you read this passage, like they're living together. And so in Judges chapter 16, we see that Delilah, she's with Samson. And the Philistine leaders, they come to Delilah and they say, Delilah, if you will tell us Samson's weakness, if you will tell us how we can defeat him, how his strength can be subdued, then each of us will give you 1,100 pieces of silver. Delilah, we're going to give you money if you would just tell us what we can do in order to make Samson weak. So just like any, terrible person, she's like, sure, that sounds great. I will tell you what you need to do in order to make Samson weak. So she goes to Samson. She says, Samson, what do I need to do? Where does your strength come from? That's where I want to look at, pick up in Judges chapter 16, verse 7. It says, Samson answered her, if anyone ties me with 7 fresh bowstrings that have not been dried, I will become as weak as any other man. Then the rulers of the Philistines brought her, who is Delilah, 7 fresh bowstrings that had been dried, and she tied him with them. With men hidden in the room, she called to him, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. But he snapped the bowstrings as easily as a piece of string snaps when it comes close to a flame. So the secret of his strength was not discovered. And so as we see what happens, she goes to Samson and she says, Samson, what's your weakness? He says, it's these bowstrings. If you just tie me up with these bowstrings, you do this, then I'm going to lose my strength. How many of you know that was a lie, right? That was a lie. Samson was lying to her. He didn't really want her to know. So again, she figures out, she's okay, Samson lied to me. So she goes to Samson again. She says, Samson, what do I need to do? How do you get your strength? What would subdue your strength? What would prevent you from being as strong? And so Samson tells her, if you would just get fresh, brand new rope, get fresh rope, and you tie me up with that. He says, I would be just as strong as any ordinary man. I wouldn't have any supernatural strength, any supernatural ability. So what did Delilah do? She says, okay, let me get the string. Let me tie him up. She gets him to sleep. And then again, the same thing. Samson, the Philistines are here to capture you. And Samson gets up. It says he snaps the string off easily. And she sees then that, hey, guess what? Samson wasn't telling the truth again. And I don't know, but you think at some point Samson's going to catch on to this, right? And so she comes and she asks again. She says, Samson. I mean, you're lying to me. Don't you love me? I mean, what do I have to do? How do you get your strength? What can prevent you from having your strength? And Samson said, if you were to weave the 7 braids of my hair into the fabric of your loom and tighten it with the loom shuttle, I would become as weak as anyone else. So what does she do? She does exactly what he says. She braids his hair. She does all of this. And so, again, he's asleep, and she says, Samson, the Philistines are coming. And again, Samson gets up. He's not hindered. Nothing happens. And so finally we see she's a little upset, right? She's like, Samson, you're supposed to love me. Samson, we're supposed to love each other, even though I'm trying to, like, hand you over to the enemy. But we're supposed to love each other, right? I want to read in verse 15. It says, then she said to him, how can you say I love you when you won't confide in me? You won't tell me anything. How do you love me, right? This is the 3rd time you have made a fool of me and haven't told me the secret of your great strength. With such nagging, she prodded him day after day until he was sick to death of it. Come on, fellas, can I get an amen? So he told her everything. No razor has ever been used on my head, he said, because I have been a Nazarite, dedicated to God from my mother's womb. If my head were shaved, my strength would leave me and I would become as weak as any other man. When Delilah saw that he had told her everything, she sent word to the rulers of the Philistines, come back once more. He has told me everything. So the rulers of the Philistines returned with silver in their hands. After putting him to sleep on her lap, she called for someone to shave off the 7 braids of his hair, and so began to subdue him, and his strength left him. Then she called, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. He woke from his sleep and thought, I'll go out as before and shake myself free. But he did not know that the Lord had left him. Then the Philistines seized him, gouged out his eyes, and took him down to Gaza. Binding him with bronze shackles, they sent him to the grinding grain in the prison. But the hair on his head began to grow again after it had been shaved. So as we read this story, you know, it's a story of downfall, right? Samson has continued throughout his life to continue to make poor decisions. I mean, it's very similar to the first time that we see Samson with a woman with his wife, and she's nagging him. What's the answer to the riddle? What's the answer to the riddle? And finally he gives in, right? And the same thing happens here. She's, Samson, how do you get your strength? Samson, how do you see it's a parallel? Samson, how do you get your strength? And again, the same thing happens. But as I look at this passage, and I look as Samson loses his strength, and Samson is taken, and Samson is seized, and his eyes are gouged out. And I think about this story, there's some things that I notice. First thing I notice is that Samson kept getting in the bed with the enemy. Come on, Samson kept getting into the bed with the enemy. That if Samson had never gotten into the bed with Delilah, if Samson had never done this, that he probably never would have lost his hair. He probably would have never lost his strength. And I believe as believers, what happens is so many times we get in bed with the enemy. So many times as believers, what happens is we're lured in and we find ourselves in bed with the enemy. Maybe in a literal sense, maybe, you know what I'm saying, right? Maybe in a literal sense, maybe in a relationship, a romantic relationship, we find ourselves in a relationship with someone who does not have the same beliefs with us. Instead of pushing us towards God, it's pulling us from God. Maybe it's a friendship, and it's strictly a friendship, but yet we're so tied to this person that we're becoming like them, and they're pulling us from God. See what I'm saying? Samson was so close to this person. There was such a connection that he was willing to tell her everything, that she meant so much to him. And I think sometimes what happens is we become so close to people who are not of God, they pull us from God. We become so close to people that are so from God that we become far from God. You see, Samson was allowing himself to be tied to somebody who didn't have his best interest in mind, was allowing himself to be tied to somebody who didn't care that he was coming against the Philistines, but she was actually working with the Philistines. I think in the same way, we oftentimes as believers find ourselves doing the same things, that we find ourselves getting in bed with the enemy. Y'all don't want to hear that, right? We find ourselves getting in bed with the enemy. We find ourselves, you know, watching things that we don't need to watch. We're getting in bed with the enemy. We find ourselves listening to things that we don't need to listen to. We're getting in bed with the enemy. We find ourselves doing things and saying things. You know, a little gossip, you know, tastes good, right? We find ourselves doing things, saying things that we shouldn't do, and what we're doing is we're in bed with the enemy. We're so tied to this addiction, we're so tied to this thing, that it's going to lead us to our demise. You see, if Samson wasn't in bed with the enemy, he never would have lost his strength. And I believe if we refuse to get in bed with the enemy, we won't lose the strength of the Holy Spirit. But when we allow ourselves to get in bed with the enemy, we allow all these things to come in that we don't need to allow to come in, that we lose our strength like Samson lost his strength. God hasn't called us to lose our strength. Not only did Samson get in bed with the enemy, but what do we see? We see Samson kept returning to the same sin. I mean, it was a struggle throughout his life. And if you read Judges chapter 16, in the first part, Samson slept with a prostitute. And then we see now he's sleeping with Delilah. We see he went and he saw his wife and he looked at her and he said, "She's good, I want her," right? We see that Samson's sin was pride and it was lust. That it was sexual desire and sexual lust, and he allowed this to control him. He allowed this to be the thing that led to his downfall. He kept returning to the same sin. You know, in the Bible, it says that if we keep returning to the same sin, we're like a dog returning to its own vomit. But yet, how many times do we come to an altar and we say, "God, I'm so sorry, I won't do it again." Then we leave and do the same thing. I believe that there's some of us in this room that we've been Christians for 10, 15, 20 years, but yet we're still struggling with the same thing that we struggled with from day one. That we find ourselves continuing to return to the same sin, continuing to return to the strength, same stronghold. You see, Samson, time and time again, he never learned his lesson. In Judges chapter 16, when Samson is in bed with the prostitute, guess what? The Philistines are waiting outside to kill him. We'll just wait till morning. Every time, and then when he marries the Philistine woman again, he comes against enemies. That every time that he gives into this sexual desire, every time he gives into this sin, that the Philistines always come against him, but he always won until now. Because eventually that sin, if you continue to return to it and continue to return to it and continue to return to it, it's got a hold on you. Because here's the thing. God can forgive us of any sin. Come on, do you believe that? That the blood of Jesus is greater than any mistake, any failure that we've ever made. But we have to repent from our sins. What does repent mean? It says that we would return from our sins, turn from our ways. And we would say, God, I'm not going to do that anymore. If you keep asking for forgiveness for the same thing that you keep doing over and over again, you haven't truly repented. And God is calling us to not just say, God, I'm sorry, but God, I repent. God, I turn from who I was. That the Bible says that when Jesus, you give your life to Jesus, that you are now a new creation, that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Yet so many Christians and so many believers continue to walk through life struggling with the same sin, struggling with the same insecurity, struggling with the same thing that's been binding them for years. Can I tell you, that's not what God has called you to. And if that's what you're living in, you will never be the person that God has called you to be. Say, Pastor Hunter, but I've prayed. Pastor Hunter, but I've done this. Pastor Hunter, but I've done that. Keep praying. Keep believing. Keep doing what you're doing. But find accountability. Find somebody to talk to. You know, the Bible says that we should confess our sins not just to God, but to men. Do you know that? And not that you need to go to a priest and say, Father, forgive me for I've sinned, right? You ain't got to do all that. But that we need to confess to one another. Why? So that we can lift each other up, so that we can hold each other accountable. You see, so many people walk through life struggling with the same thing and the same thing and the same thing because they've only confessed their sins to God and they've never said, hey, could you help me get through this? I believe God's calling us to be people who would stop returning to the same sin and stop returning to the same nonsense. You know, doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results, that's insanity. And for some of us with our Christian faith, it's almost like insanity because we keep doing the same thing, but we expect different results. Samson lost his strength because he was in bed with the enemy and because he kept returning to the same sin. If you keep returning to that same sin, it's that same sin time and time again, you're going to lose your strength. God has grace. Not only did Samson continue to return to the same sin, but Samson, he compromised. When I think about this story, what I really notice and what I really think, the theme that sticks out to me is one of compromise, right? Because she comes to him and she says, hey, Samson, what's your secret? You know, what's your kryptonite? How can we make you weak? And Samson says, well, if you just get the bowstrings, I'll be weak. Well, Samson, that didn't work, so what is it? So he compromises, says, you know, something again. He says, if you get the string, that'll make me weak. What's interesting to me is the third time he says, Delilah, if you would braid my hair and you tie it up with that fabric, right? What do we see? Every time he's getting closer. He's getting closer and closer to the truth. He's getting closer and closer to losing his strength. He's getting closer and closer until finally he says, Delilah, if you would just shave all of my head, I would lose my strength. I mean, to think about that one compromise might not kill us. One compromise might not hurt us. But the more we compromise, the more we get closer and closer to the line, the more and more we live in the gray area, the more and more we're getting further from the Lord. I begin to think about moments in my life where I've compromised. Anybody ever compromised before? Right? I'm going to think of a moment in my life where I compromised. And you guys might think this is funny. I didn't think it was funny at the time at all. Okay? But, you know, I was a youth pastor for 7 years, and if you've been in youth ministry, it's like the forgotten ministry in the church, okay? Like, you don't have no funds, you don't ever have money, so whatever you do, you got to raise the money for it. So that was me. I'm raising money, I'm doing all this stuff, but I can remember we would always, like, I don't know where I got money, but somehow I always have money. And I can remember that we would always do these trips. We'd be like, listen, we're doing team competitions. If you bring guests, you bring offering, you do this. Like, you get to go on a free ski trip, right? You get to go to Six Flags for free. Like, if your team wins, like, we balled out, okay? And so we would always do this trip to New Orleans. And I remember 1 year, you know, my budget was a little bit lower than usual. And so I was looking online. We would go, we'd stay the night, and then we'd go to the aquariums, and we'd do all of these fun things. We'd go eat beignets. You know, it was just a great time. And I can remember this time that we went, and my budget was low, so I was looking on Travelocity. That's where you get the best deals. That's what I heard, Expedia. I don't know what it was, one of those. And I can remember I saw this hotel, and it's like newly renovated. Okay, perfect, newly renovated. You know, it was like $50 under everything else. I said, that's my type of hotel, right? And so I sent it to Pastor Ashley, and she's like, yeah, I'm not really feeling that. I'm like, but it's like 4.2 stars. It's newly renovated. Like, it's going to be good. Like, it's got to be good. It's got good reviews. Anybody ever, like, you got good reviews and you went to that place, you said, who reviewed this thing? And And so we're headed there, and we get all the students right after school. We're headed there. We get there. We stop. We eat dinner. So by the time we get there, it's dark. It's nighttime. And so we get there, and we're pulling off the exit. And as I'm looking, there's our hotel right here, an adult DVD store right here. And then right next to that is like an abandoned hotel from Katrina. No windows, graffiti, homeless people everywhere. And I'm thinking, what have I done? Right? And I realized that I compromised because the price was good, right? Because the thing is a Super 8 motel, okay? I left that part out. And if you know my wife, she's not okay with anything that says motel, okay? If the doors are on the outside, she don't want to go in. And so we get there, and we're in the parking lot, and she's like, I'm not staying here. I'm not staying here. And I said, Ashley, we've paid for the room. Like, what do you want me to do? She's like, you need to call somewhere. You got to find somebody else, somewhere else. So I look, and everybody's like $200 a night. I'm like, I cannot pay for that. She's like, we'll just pay for it ourselves. I'm like, I'm not paying for that myself. So I'm like, if you go in and you cancel, we'll figure something out. So if we got to drive 30 minutes outside of New Orleans, we'll do it. We'll figure it out. So she goes in. They're like, no refunds, no cancellation, nothing. So we decide, you know what, we'll go in, and it's even worse on the inside than it was on the outside. Somehow, some way, it was even worse on the inside. Like, all of those pictures, clearly they were Photoshopped. I mean, we pulled back the sheets, and there's, like, cigarette burns in all the sheets. There's, like, we had one of our youth leaders, actually, Kristen, she's with us today. She had white socks on, and she was walking around for, like, 5 minutes, and she looked at her socks. They were, like, black. It's like, this place is dirty. It's nasty. It was so bad, we got to the point where the girls were afraid to sleep by themselves, and they had connected room. Ashley's like, you've got to come stay in my room with me. I'm not doing this. So I ended up doing that, but I got myself in that situation because I knew not to stay at a Super 8, but I compromised because the price was good. And I think so many times in our life what happens is we compromise because it looks good. We compromise because it makes us feel good. You see, Samson, he knew, I mean, he wasn't that, he couldn't have been that dumb. I mean, he couldn't have been. But Delilah made him feel good. You know, Delilah made him feel good, so he was willing to compromise and say, well, I'll tell you if it'll keep you around. I'll do this if it'll keep you around. And finally got to a point where she's like, Samson, if you really love me, if this is going to work out, you've got to tell me. So he did, because it felt good. And I believe as believers, so many times we lose our strength because we compromise and we compromise and we compromise because it feels good. We compromise and we compromise and we say, well, it makes me happy. Well, it brings joy to my life. Well, it does this and well, it does that. But if it's taking you farther from God, then you don't need to do it. And the thing about compromising is it starts out small. Samson was probably thinking, well, I'll tell her this and then nothing will come from it and nothing will happen. I'll tell her about the bowstrings, but she's not going to get seven. Well, I mean, where's she going to get seven bowstrings from? I mean, who says that? Seven bowstrings. But sure enough, she went and got the seven bowstrings. And sure enough, when you compromise a small thing, it takes you to a bigger thing. Well, it's just one drink. Well, it's just one episode. Well, we just need to pray about her. We just need to pray about it. You know, I'm just telling you so we can pray about it, right? Just a little gossip. Just a little this. It's just a little that. Until we find ourselves and we get to this place where Samson, we're so deep and we're so lost that you know what? Eventually what happens is we lose our strength and we break covenant with God. You see, because what happened is it wasn't the fact that Samson compromised. It wasn't even that he got in the bed with the enemy. But what happened is that Samson compromised to the place that he broke covenant with God. Because what was the covenant that he said, since I was in the womb, I was marked to be a Nazarite, that my hair has never been cut. That's what he said. And the moment that his hair was cut, he broke covenant with God. And I believe the moment where we allow our compromise to lead us to a place of sin, we're breaking covenant with God. And I believe if we're breaking covenant with God, we're losing our strength just like Samson lost his strength. You see, because when we give our lives to Jesus, what we're saying is, God, I give you all I am, that I'm a new creation. But yet when we go back to who we once were, that prayer really didn't mean that much, did it? You see, most of the time what happens is, you know, people don't just like one day wake up and say, I'm going to have an affair on my wife. But it's one compromise after another compromise after another compromise after another compromise until you find yourself laying in the bed. I don't think people wake up and say, you know what, I'm just going to turn my back on God and leave the church one morning. But it's, man, I can miss this Sunday, and I can miss that Sunday, and I can do this, and I can do that. And we get to this place, and man, it's been a month since we went to church. Sundays, free Sundays is pretty good. It's been a month since I haven't paid my tithes. Look at all this extra money. And what happens is it's compromise after compromise after compromise. It's one thing after another after another after another. You see, for Samson, it was Delilah, but I wonder for us today, what is it? What is your Delilah? What is that thing in your life that's causing you to compromise? What is that thing in your life that's preventing you from being all in with the Lord? What's that thing that's preventing you from truly being who God has called you to be? And we look at this passage and we think, I mean, Samson's strength, it came from his hair. There was something magical about it, but it was his covenant with God. Because when Samson got up, it didn't say Samson realized. It didn't say Samson was like, oh, where's my hair? It says that the Lord had left him. And I believe for some of us, we get to a place and we're so far gone and we're so far away from God that, God, where are you? And not that God's left us, because the Bible says that he'll never leave you and he'll never forsake you, but yet we've walked away from him. And we get to a place and we're so far away from him, we say, God, where are you? And he says, I'm still where you're supposed to be. But yet, because we've compromised and we took one misstep and one misstep, if you're lost and you keep making the wrong turns, you're going to get real lost. And that's what happens when we compromise. It's one left here, one right here, one right there, until we don't know where we're at. And I believe there's so many people, so many believers, so many people who love the Lord, so many pastors, so many leaders, so many Christians who've lived a life of compromise for way too long. Well, God understands. God knows my heart. The Bible says that everything you do flows from where? Your heart. God might know your heart, but he also knows your actions. I wonder, are you allowing the enemy to subdue your strength because you're living a life of compromise? What happened in this story is Samson's strength was able to be subdued, and he found himself with his eyes gouged, with his hair cut out, being used basically as a mule, as a trophy, because his compromise. That the Philistines were able to look at him and say, look, there's Samson, there's the great judge of Israel. They're able to do that. Why? Because he compromised. Well, Israel's God must not be too big because there's their judge. Look, he's doing the work of a mule. And when we compromise, guess what? People look at us and say, well, you know, God must not be too good because look what they're doing. They had an affair just like everybody else. They're in the same bar that I'm in. They're doing the same thing that I'm doing. Come on, somebody. And the enemy is able to look and say, look, their God must not be too big. You don't need him. That's what the enemy did in this story. What is he doing in your story? You see, Samson's life could have been so much more. Could have been so much more. I mean, you continue to read, and he eventually breaks the pillars down, and he kills 3,000 Philistines, and it says that he killed more in his death than he did in his life. I don't know about you, but I don't want my death to be greater than my life. But because Samson was compromising and compromising and compromising, got to the end of his life, and he did something supernatural, he did something amazing, cried out to God one last time. Don't wait until you're on your deathbed to say, God, I need you. He'll show up, but don't wait till then. See, Samson waited to the last moment when he's weak and people are pointing at him, people laughing him and mocking him and mocking God. They says, God, would you give me strength one more time? He pulls the pillars down and thousands of Philistines are killed. You see, it says that Samson was supposed to begin the deliverance from the Philistines, but it wasn't until Samuel and David that the Israelites were delivered. Don't wait until your kids and your grandkids to bring change to your family. Don't wait for your kids and your grandkids to break the curse in your family. You get what I'm saying? Don't let your death be the greatest moment that people come to your funeral. Wow, they were an awesome person. But as you live your life, that you would do great things. And the only way we're going to do that is if we refuse to get in bed with the enemy.
If we refuse to compromise, we refuse to return to the same sin. And in order to do that, we have to identify what our Delilah is. Or maybe even who our Delilah is. If I could have the worship team join me, I feel there's some in this room, and I'm not saying you don't love Jesus. I'm not saying like you're a sinner or a bad person. I mean, we're all sinners, right? But I'm not saying you're a bad person, but what I'm saying is maybe there's some areas in your life where you've compromised. You've been doing some things that you know you shouldn't be doing. You've been, you know, little compromises. Well, I'll say this, I'll say that, I'll do this, I'll do that, and we don't realize where it's leading us and where it's taking us. But can I tell you, it's going to take you to the same place that Samson was taken, a place of captivity and a place of bondage. Samson was taken as a prisoner. Has your compromises made you a prisoner? Maybe you're watching online. Have your compromises made you a prisoner? Can we all stand together? Can we just bow our heads and can we just lift our hands to heaven right now? Come on, all across this room, can we just lift both hands? Just as a moment of surrender, and can you just begin to ask, God, what is my area of compromise? God, what is my Delilah? God, what is it in my life that's leading me not to you, but from you? God, is it how I'm acting at work? Is it the parent that I'm being? Is it the spouse that I'm being? God, is it the things that I'm allowing into my mind and allowing into my home, the things I'm watching on TV? God, is it the things that I'm listening to? God, what is it that's preventing me? God, what is it that's the compromises that's preventing me from walking into more? God, is it my tongue? Is it my mouth? Is it my attitude? God, is it pride inside of me that I feel like I know better? God, what is it inside of me that it's the compromises? It's the small things. You see, Satan's never gonna try and get you to do a big thing if he can just have you doing the small things. Because sin is sin to God. Compromise is compromise. Why is he going to make you have an affair if you're looking at pornography? Why is he going to make you to cuss somebody out when you're already gossiping? See what I'm saying? Where's the compromise? Father, right now, Lord, I pray that you would reveal the compromises. God, I pray that you would reveal the places in our lives where we've taken steps not to you but from you. Lord, I pray that those in this room that feel so far from you, God, I pray, Lord, that you would draw them back, that you would show them that you've never left them, that you've never forsaken them, but Lord, your promises are still yes and amen for them. God, that they're still sons and daughters and you're calling them back just like the prodigal son, and God, that you're calling them back to you with arms wide open. It doesn't matter how big the sin was or how small the sin was, but God, you're calling them back. You see, I said that there's a difference between asking for forgiveness and repenting, and I believe that we just need to repent this morning. You say, Pastor, I'm a Christian, I'm a believer. Okay, what does that matter? Every day when I pray, you know what I do? I repent. I say, God, if there's things in my life that I don't even know I'm doing, God, would you forgive me? And God, would you reveal them to me so I can turn from them? I believe what God wants us to do is God wants us to repent, because you know I felt the Lord moving so strongly during worship. But if we truly want the manifestation, if we truly want the supernatural outpouring, we've got to live a life of repentance. That when we sin, we say, God, I'm sorry. God, I'm turning back to you. That not every time that we mess up, we're going to hell, because that's not who Jesus is. But we would turn from that so that we can be closer to him. Come on, can we just lift our hands in this room, and can you begin to repent? Maybe things you've done, maybe things you don't know you've done. Maybe this week you lost your cool with somebody at work. Maybe this week you spewed off at your kids or at your wife. Maybe this week you looked at some things, you watched some things that the Holy Spirit told you not to, that you felt that conviction, you felt that thing inside of you that says, this just isn't good. Can we just begin to repent? Father, would you forgive us? Come on, just begin to ask him to forgive you. Father, would you forgive me? God, would you forgive me of my transgressions? Would you forgive me of my failures? God, would you forgive me of my mistakes, of the times where I've compromised, of the times I got in bed with the enemy, of the times where I went back to the same old things that I used to do? And God, that's not who I am, but I am a new creation. Come on, can you tell them that this morning? God, I am a new creation. God, I am a new, come on, tell them that. God, I'm a new creation. I'm not who I was before you found me, but God, you made me new. God, you've made me new. God, you've made me new. And Holy Spirit, I pray right now all across this room, God, reveal to us the small compromises. God, reveal to us the things that hinder us from encountering and going deeper in your presence and in your spirit. God, reveal to us, God, the small sins, the small foxes. God, the pride, the hard-headedness, the anger, the bitterness, the unforgiveness. God, the small things. Not just the big things, but God, the small things. The way we talk to people. God, would you reveal it? God, would you show it? God, lead us out of captivity and into freedom. God, it doesn't matter how old we are. God, there's still redemption, just like there was for Samson. Doesn't matter how far off we are, God, there's still redemption like there was for Samson. Come on, we're going to worship for just a moment. And if you feel like you need to come front, I would encourage you, come front. I feel like it's a moment of surrender, a moment of repentance, or a moment of saying, God, wherever I've turned from you, God, I want to be fully turned towards you. Because the Bible says that wide is the path that leads to destruction. But narrow and straight is the path that leads to salvation. That God, we don't want to just be a little off, but God, we want to be headed down the straight and narrow path. God, we want to be on the narrow road that leads to you, that leads to salvation. So can we sing and can we just enter into a moment of repentance where we say, God, I'm turning completely and everything all over to you. Come on, let's lift our hands and lift our voices this morning. Lift your hands and sing this all my life. God, we just thank you. God, we repent. God, we return from our ways. God, the moments when we compromise, and God, we want to know you. God, we want to know you deeper. God, we want to know you deeper. God, we want to know you deeper. God, we want to know you more. God, we want to know you more. God, we want to walk towards you. God, that there's, come on, God has a purpose for your life. If you're here today, it doesn't matter where you've been, what you've done, where you grew up in church, God has a purpose and God has a plan for your life. Don't let the compromise prevent you from reaching your purpose. Don't let the compromise prevent you from reaching your calling. And sometimes the compromise isn't sin, but sometimes it's just not what God wants for you and God has for you. That God has this for you, but you say, God, I'm going to go over there. And so I feel what God is saying is, God is saying, step into who he has called you to be and created you to be, that you have purpose, that Samson's life had purpose. It was so much more than just breaking pillars. It was so much more than laying in bed with Delilah. It was so much more than killing 1,000 people with the jawbone of a donkey, but it was to bring deliverance. Your life has purpose. Ask yourself, am I walking in that purpose, or am I allowing the Delilah to prevent me? Father, right now, God, I pray that we would be men and women who would walk in your purpose. God, that we would be men and women, God, that would walk in the purpose and the plan that you have for us. Lord, I pray that we would be all that you've called us to be. God, if we're wondering, if we're going our own ways, if we have questions, Lord, I pray right now that you'd bring clarity, that today would be a day of clarity. God, that we would see who you've called us to be, and we wouldn't allow the compromises, we wouldn't allow the things that seem good, that maybe even seem God, to prevent us. God, we want to know it's God. We want to know it's you. Holy Spirit, we want to know it's you. God, if there's job opportunities, God, let us know it's you. God, if there's relationships, God, let us know it's you. If there's friendships, God, let us know it's you. God, let nothing be in our life that would prevent us from reaching you. God, let there nothing be in our life that would prevent us from your spirit and your goodness and your strength. God, less of us and more of you. God, today we get the Delilahs out of our lives. We get the compromises out of our lives. And God, we declare that we are an all-in church. God, all in, not just for a vision of a pastor, but God, we're all in the kingdom of God. God, we love you. We thank you for who you are. God, I thank you for all you're doing at Creola Assembly. I thank you, Lord, that we're seeing souls saved and lives changed. And God, I believe that as we walk in our purpose, God, we're going to see more and more, not just at our church, but in our day-to-day walk. God, we love you. We thank you. We give you all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody said amen. We love you guys so much. On your way out, make sure you stop, grab some flyers, invite somebody. Family Fest this Friday. And also, we need all of our volunteers here at close to 5:30 as possible on Friday night. It's going to be a great night. Invite somebody. We love you guys so much.